Good morning. Glad you're here with us today to worship the Lord and share fellowship with one another. Our call to worship this morning comes from Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 4. Let each one of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. And have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, and being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by being obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let's pray together. We confess, Jesus, you are Lord. You are our Savior. You are our merciful Redeemer, our friend. You've shown us a great, great kindness for your glory and by your grace. We come to worship you this morning in spirit and truth. Amen.
Amen, church. Let's stand as we worship the Lord together through song this morning.
Oh, God and how confounding it is sometimes to understand all that takes place in our lives. Well, that's where Solomon was in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. It's good to be with you this morning, and for those online, good to have you with us. Those watching the DVD later, good that you're doing that as well. I want to read some of the passage, chapter 3 of Ecclesiastes, and then we'll go to a time of prayer. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and I'll be reading the first 8 verses. There is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. Time to give birth and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to shun embracing. A time to search and a time to give up as lost. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear apart and a time to sew together. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. Let's pray together. Father, we acknowledge your sovereignty over time and over circumstances, including events of our world, local events, personal events, family joys and trials. Help us to be helped by this chapter to grow in responding in faith and in reverence of you. Lord, we thank you for our fellowship that is not here with us but watching online. Thank you. Encourage them. We pray for the situation in our county, our state, our nation, and around the world with the coronavirus. We pray, Father, that more and more it would be safe for individuals, and we pray that our full fellowship will be together again soon. But thank you for those. Thank you that we're able to meet in safe ways, and thank you, Father, that we're able to assemble together. We pray that you would protect that here and around the world for our churches. Lord, thank you for your sovereignty over all things. Help us to rejoice in that, to be comforted by it, to be encouraged and thrilled by it this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
May you remain seated as we continue to sing together this morning.
Behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Trace your stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in him we stand. Christ the Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the
perspective. So we see Solomon's accounting of his thoughts and sometimes struggles with things happening under the sun. Not only are, he reminds us, but not only a reminder to look above the sun to God, but also to look at it from a Christian perspective as well. So we'll see that this morning as well. But I want us to start by acknowledging two obvious truths, and they're inescapable truths. We can't stop time. And secondly, we can't stop many of the things that happen to us during our lifetime. Let's also acknowledge that it's beyond us most of the time to make sense of time and circumstances. And when things take a turn that we don't expect, illness, death of loved ones, financial loss, accidents, etc. Let's acknowledge that it's difficult in the moment to find purpose and hope, and yet God would want us to live with purpose and hope in all time and circumstances. Well, Solomon's struggle in this book is to some extent every person's struggle. We believe Ecclesiastes, and I say that confidently, we believe Ecclesiastes is inspired scripture, and we see chapter by chapter God calling us to trust, and especially in this chapter, to trust his providence and to live by faith and in reverence, fear of him. So let's look at six truths from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, first truth that you see on the outline. We must acknowledge that God has a reason for all that happens in our lives. Verses 1 through 8. We all have things that happen that cause us to ask the question, why me or why now? But God has a purpose for everything that happens in our lives. Verse 1. There is an appointed time for everything. Well, let's stop and ask the question that should be asked: appointed by whom? Who orders the times and events? Well, the answer is God does. We know that. Solomon knows that too. He's going to tell us that in the chapter. But we know it throughout Scripture. And we'll see it throughout Scripture this morning. It will become clear that though man has no control over time and little control over events, God is viewed differently, and we should view him differently. He is, listen, he is not reacting. He is controlling. He is orchestrating. So there's an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. If God is in control of time and events, if his sovereignty encompasses this, then the seemingly random nature of events is not random. What Solomon hints at, I declare to you from all of Scripture, and that is that God's sovereignty covers every event. There is a predetermined time for every event, which is what this verse is declaring, including both a beginning point and a duration. And God has a purpose and an appointed time for everything that is happening. That's where Scripture leads us, and you'll see that as we go through it. Man will continue to deny that truth. Man will, in general, will continue to act as though he is the master of his own destiny. The great conclusion drawn in this passage is that man cannot control the events and circumstances of his life. So God should be feared, Solomon says. God should be looked to and reverenced in every event of our lifetime. Now, 28 activities are listed in the first 8 verses, well, actually verses 2 through 8. They're in 14 pairs, 2 pairs in each verse. 14 negative things, 14 positive things. So let's look at them together again. A time to give birth and a time to die. You've experienced both in your lifetime, both personally, but also you've experienced the birth of children, most of you, or many of you, or the birth of nieces or nephews, brothers, sisters. A time to plant, a time to uproot. What is planted? I did that recently. Uprooted some things that I did not want to have to fool with and planted grass. I hope it works. A time to kill. A time to heal. A time to tear down. And a time to build up. A time to weep. A time to laugh. A time to mourn. And a time to dance. A time to throw stones, and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace, a time to shun, embracing. A time to search, and a time to give up as lost. That's hard, but that's important. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. Many of us still struggle with that second part, throwing things away or getting rid of things. A time to tear apart, a time to sew together. Time to be silent and a time to speak, so important. Time to love and a time to hate. I would interpret that as hating things that God hates for us, wanting to obey him. A time for war and a time for peace. David was a man whose time was warfare, but Solomon not so. The nation enjoyed peace in his time. So interesting perspective as he writes verse 8. Well, here's where we want to go to some scriptures and be convinced of the providence of God, first of all, which I think is spoken of here in these 7 verses. So biblically, or these 8 verses, biblically we must acknowledge the providence of God. That is, that God is in control and that he really controls the affairs of people's lives. So, cross-references. You can see them listed there, and I'm going to read them one by one. Psalm 115, verse 3. Think about each one. Our God is in the heavens. He does whatever he pleases. Psalm 135, 5 and 6. I know that the Lord is great, and that our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and in earth. So the emphasis here is his providence. He actually does these, not just that he could if he wanted to, he does in heaven and in earth, in the seas and in all deeps, everywhere. Psalm 139, verse 16. David prays, God, your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. Did you know that about David? He lived to the very day that God had given him. But not just David, you and I will live the very days that God has ordained for us. Daniel 4, verse 35, all the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing. But he, God, does according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of earth. And no one can ward off his hand or say to him, what have you done? And then one more, Psalm 31, verse 15. Psalmist writes, my times are in your hand. Augustine said, if the providence of God does not preside over the affairs of men, in other words, if these verses are not true, there's no need to bother about religion. How about that? In other words, would you really want to have anything to do with a God who was not able to control every event in the universe? Well, we want God, and he is that God. Could we really trust him if he wasn't, if he was just reacting to things? No, he's a God of providence. So biblically, we must acknowledge that. Biblically, secondly, we must acknowledge the purpose of God. God has a specific purpose behind all that happens. Now, I'm not suggesting we can know all of his purposes. That's what Solomon is saying to us. We're not going to know all of them. But I believe that he does. And here's some examples of it. You see the texts on the outline. Think of Joseph, his being sold into slavery by his brothers. And he says to them when he sees them, at the end of the book of Genesis, chapter 50, verse 20, as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive. Mordecai says to Esther, in the book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 14, if you remain silent at this time, because she was the queen and could speak to the king, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place, and you and your father's house will perish. Who knows whether you have not attained royalty for such a time as this? The circumstances, the times, God had a purpose in them. Paul says to Silas in Acts chapter 16, verse 6, or Paul and Silas were experiencing this, I should say, in Acts chapter 16, they passed through the Phrygian and Galatian region, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. It's puzzling to us that they would be forbidden to speak the gospel, but they were. And after they came to Mysia, they were trying to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit of Jesus did not permit them. And passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas. A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing and appealing to him and saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. When he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So in their thoughts, thinking back to what had happened, no, the purpose of God kept us out of those other places because he wanted us to come to Macedonia. Listen to Paul's sermon in Acts chapter 17, 26 and 27. He declares, God made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth. So from Adam, all the nations exist. God did that, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation, that they would seek God, if perhaps they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. But how about what he says about the nations? Not just true as he's standing in Athens giving the sermon, but it's a truth for all time. Then Peter declares in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, the Lord is not slow about his promise of judgment to come, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. I don't know how many years until Jesus comes, but there's going to be a generation alive when he does come, and God will have shown patience to some in that generation who will be saved shortly before he comes, because he has purposed it so. The purpose of God. We acknowledge God has a specific purpose behind times and circumstances. Now, some people disagree that God has a reason for all that happens in our lives, suggesting that God has an overall purpose, but not specific purposes. But that's not what Scripture teaches, okay? So we need to believe what Scripture declares, which is what we've been reading. And what Scripture declares is what God declares. You understand that? It is his word. And he says that his purpose is behind everything. Let me read one more verse. Psalm 37, well, not one more for the sermon, one more for this point. Psalm 37, verse 23, the steps of a man are established by the Lord. Did you hear that? The steps of a man, that's specific, are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. God is not limited by anything or anybody in accomplishing his purpose. We talk about bad circumstances, but we must realize that God has a time and a purpose for everything in our lives. Thirdly, we must acknowledge the power of God. God can cause things to happen whenever he wants, to whomever he wants. Think of Abraham and Sarah in Genesis chapter 18. Verse 13, the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I indeed bear a child when I am so old? Is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you at this next year, and Sarah will have a son. Job 42, verse 2, after being reproved by God, after God recites to him a list of how powerful he is in creation, Job says, I know you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28, do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable. Our God is not wearing out, okay? He's as powerful as he has ever been. He is eternal. Amen. Jeremiah 32, verse 17. Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for you. Daniel 2, 21. It is he who changes the times and the epochs. He removes kings and establishes kings. He gives wisdom to wise men and knowledge to men of understanding. Amen. So we're not taught to pray for good leaders, as we would define good. We're taught to pray for our leaders. He brings them into position. He removes kings and establishes kings. Jesus said, looking at those who were questioning if he could do a certain miracle in Matthew 19, 26, or questioning why the disciples could not do a particular miracle, he said, with people this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Can God really cause anything to happen? This is a question for you. Can God really cause anything to happen at any time to anybody? Your pastor answers yes. What do you say?
Yes.
He is intimately involved in the affairs of our lives. We do not fully understand it. David said in Psalm 139, "It is too high, I cannot attain to it." But the Bible definitely teaches it. Yes, it's too high. Yes, we cannot attain to it. But don't let that make you think it can't be true. Don't let your mind be the standard, your understanding be the standard for what can be true. God is much bigger than you and me. So we must accept, as we look at the list of all that happens in our lives in verses 2 through 8, that God has a reason for all that happens in our lives. He has a reason for the appointing of it and for the timing of it. Number 2, we must accept God's purpose and control over all that happens. We must accept God's purpose and control over all that happens. Verses 9 through 11. This means accepting what he uses to accomplish his purpose. We may not choose that or like that. But after mentioning 28 activities of man, Solomon asks in verse 9, what profit is there to the worker from that in which he toils? In other words, with all that we can do, we can't be sure or what we do will be secure from the changes that time and circumstances bring. You see what he's saying? It's out of our control, and yet we work to try to make things under our control, but we can never be sure. What profit is there to the worker from that in which he toils? You may not never have asked that question. Maybe you've been able to put your money to good use, but I'm certain some who are faced with the disasters of hurricane, tornado, earthquake have asked such questions. What's it all, you know, look at what I've done, it's all gone. Verse 10, I've seen the task which God has given the sons of men with which to occupy themselves. I've closely considered the labors of men. And verse 11 is the conclusion of his observation. He, God, has made everything appropriate in its time. And that word appropriate actually means beautiful in its time. So this is a positive statement, very positive. He, God, has made everything appropriate. We might say perfect in its time. That is, God controls the times of our lives, and what happens to us, which we would never welcome. But if we're going to be biblical people, we have to say it is appropriate. It is beautiful from God's perspective in its timing and purpose. Now, don't get me wrong. There are things that we deal with, such as disease, because of the fallenness of our world. And so I'm not saying that disease is beautiful, but the timing of that and how God works through it and shapes our lives and conforms us to the image of Christ in our patience and dependence upon him while having disease or illness or pain or whatever it is, tragedy, well, that certainly we can say is appropriate because he's always conforming us to the image of Christ. The verse goes on. He has also set eternity in their heart. That is, God has established in man, that's who they are in the verse, in mankind, an impulse that leads us beyond the temporal to that which is eternal. I think that's what Solomon is saying. He has set eternity in their heart, but not to the place that we can comprehend the eternal purposes of God. Look at it. He's made everything appropriate in its time. He has set eternity in their heart yet so that man will not find out the work which God has done from the beginning even to the end. So the specifics of it are going to be a mystery to us, but believing that God knows specifics, that's pretty clear in Scripture. And Paul agrees with that. He agrees with Solomon's conclusion about not being able to figure it all out in our minds when he says in Romans 11:33, "Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgment and unfathomable his ways," as he looked at the plan of salvation and the salvation going to the Gentiles and the Jews rejecting Christ, but believing Jews continuing to be the vine, the Gentiles grafted in and so forth. And he's looking at all of that and saying, "Oh, the depth of both the rich wisdom and knowledge of God, riches of it." So we must accept God's purpose and control over all that happens. That's the step of faith. Thirdly, we must appreciate the time we have as a gift from God. Verse 12, "I know that there is nothing better than for them," mankind, than to rejoice and to do good in one's lifetime. Solomon is encouraging himself and others to live life with a good attitude and live life with goodness. So be thankful for your days and seek to do good in your days. Rejoice, do good. Verse 13, "Moreover, that every man who eats and drinks sees good in all his labor, it is the gift of God." To live life with thankfulness, I think, is what he's getting at there in verse 13. Thankfulness for the good things that our labor provides in life. I think every one of us in this room will go to a home or someone's home after church, and we will likely have good food to eat. It is right to be thankful for those things that have been accomplished through labor. It is good to remember the blessings of life and to enjoy them. Fourthly, we must apply the truths of God's sovereignty over time and events or circumstances to our own attitude toward God. Okay, this is where it gets personal for you. Verse 14, "I know," Solomon writes, "I know that everything God does will remain forever. There's nothing to add to it. There's nothing to take from it. For God has so worked that men should fear him." So I might ask, and I will, who is the master of your fate day by day? Is it you? Or is it God? Now, certainly we are creatures with decision-making capabilities. But ultimately, the master of our fate day by day is the Lord God. This verse gives the solid answer. God is. Everything God does will remain forever. Not you. Amen. And since this is true, the appropriate answer and the designed response is to fear God. To reverence God. To know that God is audience to all of your history. And to know that all, including you, will give an account to him. That's what verse 15 is saying. "That which is, has been already, and that which will be, has already been. For God seeks what has passed by." That's a puzzling verse, but I believe it is pointing to this, that though history comes and goes and seems to repeat itself, every act in history comes to judgment. God sees what is past, and that's not forgotten. It's brought to judgment as well. So we must apply the truths of God's sovereignty over time and events to our own attitude toward God and fear him in the way of reverencing him. Fifth, we must live in light of God's judgment. Furthermore, verse 16, "I have seen under the sun that in the place of justice there is wickedness, and in the place of righteousness there is wickedness." So man's judgment of right and wrong during the course of history will be inconsistent with God's will in every generation. God's will is the righteousness that Solomon is speaking of, and that will come to judgment. Verse 17, I said to myself, God will judge both the righteous man and the wicked man, for a time for every matter and for every deed is there. God's judgment will be complete. Remember, several times we've looked at the end, and that's the conclusion he comes to in chapter 12. Every act comes to God's judgment. Verse 18, I said to myself concerning the sons of men, God has surely tested them in order for them to see that they are but beasts. That is, we are mortal creatures. That is how he's using the comparison there. For the fate of the sons of men and the fate of beasts is the same. The fate, see, that's the comparison he's making. As one dies, so dies the other. Indeed, they all have the same breath, and there's no advantage for man over beast, for all is vanity. Now, if purpose in life is sought solely, if you're seeking purpose just on the fact that man is superior to other creatures, and I would make the case that we are, because we are made in the image of God. But if that's what you're trying to do, then that alone is empty thinking, for death comes to all creatures. In other words, without anything else, you just know, yeah, God made me special, so I'm special. That's not enough. That's empty thinking, because you're going to die. That's what he says in verse 20. All go to the same place. All came from the dust and all return to the dust. So any superiority that person thinks, who just knows he's better than animals, it disappears when he dies. But we know there's more to the life and death of a human. There's judgment to come. Verse 21. Who knows that the breath of man ascends upward, and the breath of the beast descends downward to the earth? Who knows that one has an eternal soul and the other doesn't? I would say Solomon does know that the breath of man, of man's soul, in other words, man's soul, does go back to God, because he says so in Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7. He doesn't say it here, but he does say it there. Dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. So here's what I say. These are puzzling challenging verses, but I would say they certainly teach, as we look at them from a whole counsel of God perspective, they teach that you and I need to live with more than a beast mentality. Because if we live with a beast mentality, we're simply going to do what we please for the days of our life. We're going to follow our instincts until we die. We need to live in light of something that happens after we die, and that is the facing of God's judgment, eternal life. Number six, it's also true, not only do we live for judgment to come, we must live for the present day. So verse 22, I've seen that nothing is better than that man should be happy in his activities, for that is his lot. For who will bring him to see what will occur after him? The last part, we can't know what tomorrow holds, is what he's saying. Who will bring him to see what will occur after him? There is a scriptural encouragement to live each day, to seize the day, so to speak. Jesus put it this way, seek first, with purpose seize the day, seek first his kingdom and righteousness and all these things, other things that people seek and put too much attention on, food, clothing, and so forth. He said, Jesus did, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. All these other things will be added to you. Don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. So understood from the whole counsel of God, we must live for the present day, not without thought of God, but with thought of God. We should live for the present day. And today will bring things that you enjoy. Be thankful for them. Today may bring challenges as well. Fear God in those challenges. Pray to him. Trust him in them. Taking one day at a time, We should enjoy whatever blessings God gives, and we should turn to Him in whatever challenges come our way. Some implications. Number one, we walk by faith and not by sight. And we leave the unanswered questions and prayers reverently with Him. Okay? That means you're not going to figure it all out. That means you may live never understanding why certain things had to take place, or even knowing the lesson of them. But there needs to be a rest in that, a resting in that of your soul, where you leave those kind of questions and those unanswered prayers reverently with Him and keep trusting that He's going to do what He will do for the believer, and that is to conform you to the image of Christ. So we walk by faith, not by sight. Amen. Number two, we trust that God works all things together for good. We know that verse. Do we believe that verse? We trust that God works all things together for good to those who love Him, conforming us to the image of Christ. Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 29. I thought of that verse often in my study of chapter 3. Because I believe that is a step of faith in my heart to keep believing that. That all things work together for good. So, again, there's unanswered questions there. I mean, why did Pastor John's air conditioning fail this week and make me a little warmer in my car? Not an important thing. But I don't know the answer to that question. I never will. I'll get it fixed. And I'll be thankful and maybe have conversation with my mechanic. Amen. That's what I can trust, right, John?
Amen.
Yeah. Trust that all things work together for good. Thirdly, we celebrate God's eternal plan. We read Ecclesiastes from a New Testament perspective. Don't forget that. Jesus has come, and Jesus will come again, and there will be a new heaven and a new earth, and God is saving souls, and we find purpose in seeking Christ because we know as His chosen people that there is something beyond death. We don't live with a beast mentality. We live seeking Christ, looking for Christ, longing to be with Him in His eternal kingdom. So in a devotional reading of this chapter, I rejoice to see the gospel described in verse 14. Look back at verse 14, if you would. Put your eyes on it. I know that everything God does will remain forever. Well, one thing that God did was give His only Son as Savior. God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf. And those who receive His saving work on the cross, there's no expiration date to that. I know that everything God does will remain forever. One example of that is the salvation that we have in Christ. It is secure. It is eternal. We throw food away when it expires. Your salvation has no expiration date. There's nothing to add to it, verse 14 says. Isn't that true about the gospel? There's nothing to take from it. Christ is sufficient. Nothing needs to be added. The last Sunday in October, you'll hear that in a special way on a Reformation sermon by Pastor Matt, Justification by Faith Alone. Amen? Not only is Christ sufficient, Christ is necessary. There's nothing to add to it. There's nothing to take from it. Nothing can be substituted. Okay? There is only one way of salvation. See it. In verse 14, as an example of verse 14, I say, for God has so worked that men should fear Him. Salvation is not of works, so that no one can boast, so that we will honor and fear and praise our God. The author of eternal salvation in Jesus means eternal damnation is the default position of every person. God has so worked, sending his Son, putting his Son on the cross, that men should fear him. If one rejects Christ, they are in that default position, and there is no other hope because Christ is necessary. Galatians 4:4 says it this way. Think about times and circumstances as we've been thinking about them. Galatians 4:4, when the fullness of the time came, God sent forth his Son. By God's providence, you, many of you, most of you in this room, heard the gospel. By God's grace, you repented of your sin, believed in Jesus. God, by God's providence, you're here today. And all of you that are here today, not all of you, have become Christians. So I would exhort you, because you are here today, by God's providence, admit your sin. Admit your need of forgiveness of your sin, because you will stand before God. Believe that in Jesus' death, your sin was paid for. Confess Jesus as the Lord Amen. Of your life.
Amen.
And then you'll have a perspective on life that goes beyond the sun. You'll have confidence as you think about life beyond death. Let's pray together. Well, Father, we thank you for your sovereignty, your providence in all things. And Father, we admit with Solomon, we can't comprehend that, and it does trouble us. We admit that as well. It's sinful that it does, but it does. But keep bringing us back to that walk of faith, that walk of fear in you that is right and honors you. And Father, where needed, bring hearts to Jesus today, I pray. It's in his name. We know you can. We know you're all powerful. We pray for that work in our midst, the work of salvation in hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. The worship team will come forward and prepare to, we will sing together, He is Lord. And as we sing that, just celebrate that. Jesus is Lord. And if God has put upon your heart a need for prayer, personal prayer this morning, I'd be glad to pray with you, or others would here at the front. Or if God has put on your heart to join North Harford Baptist Church or to profess your faith that you might be baptized, please come as we stand together and sing, He is Lord.
Empty of his glory, God became a man. To walk on earth in ridicule and shame. A ruler yet a servant, a shepherd yet a lamb, a man of sorrows, agony and pain. Humbled and rejected, beaten and despised, upon the cross the Son of sinless sacrifice, but by his death his loss became our gain. Satan's forces crumbled like a mighty wall. The stone that held him in was rolled aside. The Prince of Life in glory was lifted over all. Echo with the cry.
guest with us this morning, we hope you'll fill out the connect card there in the pew rack and then just set it, give it to one of us or set it at the welcome center in the back, and hope we'll get to meet you before you go. Bless you. We'll see you this evening.